morning, whether you're joining us here on campus or online, we invite you to worship and praise the King. Your song, but our thoughts with wonder and awe, give us a great, never-changing God.
All we want and all we need is found in you, Jesus.
Have the wonderful opportunity to participate with and join in with two that are coming to be baptized this morning. Pastor Frank.
We are so excited today to be with two wonderful young ladies that are following Jesus in believer's baptism. Have you followed the Lord Jesus in believer's baptism? This is Jana Rosada. I'm so happy to be with you, Jana, as you follow Jesus in baptism. So Jana, my sister, in the Lord Jesus Christ, I baptize you in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Baptism is one way of showing that we've decided to follow Jesus. Amen. Another wonderful young lady, Deva. Come right ahead. Deva. Thank you, Deva. Congratulations. Congratulations. It's so exciting, Deva. Deva, my sister, of the Lord Jesus Christ. I baptize you in the name of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. Baptism is one way of showing we've decided to follow Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Are you thankful for that truth? That in Christ we find our hope and our strength. And sometimes it's hard to see that. Amen. In the moment when things are going bad and we don't know which way to turn and it just feels like God is not hearing us. But I just want to encourage you that in the silence and even when you feel like he's not at work, God is always at work on your behalf. He's making us more like himself. And he's teaching us to wait and to trust in him. Amen. Scripture says in Psalm 27, 13 through 14, I believe that I shall look upon the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Verse 14 says, wait for the Lord. Be strong. Let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. So we're going to sing a song that proclaims that very truth, that we find strength, hope, when we wait on the Lord. I don't believe in fairy tales. I guess I've outgrown them. But that doesn't mean that I don't believe that there's something bigger than me. 'Cause I've seen it in a hospital room when the doctor said sorry. There's nothing more we can do. Well, it wasn't through. I've never seen a pot of gold at the end of the rainbow. But I've got a promise I can hold in the middle of the struggle. God, if you said it, you'll perform it. How I want you to, but here's what I'll do. I'm gonna wait on you. I'm gonna wait on you. I've tasted your goodness. I'll trust in your promise. I'm gonna wait on you. I'm gonna wait on you. I've tasted your goodness. Trust in your promise. I'm gonna wait on you. Help me in the waiting, Lord. Oh. I know you order every step. Yet you are the author. There's no predicting what is next. Hold the future. All the questions, they come second to the one I know is true. Yeah, you've always been true. So I'm gonna wait on you. I'm gonna wait on you. I've tasted your goodness. I'll trust in your promise. I'm gonna wait on you. Trust in your promise. I'm gonna wait on you. Yeah. I don't mind waiting. Yeah. Oh, we can trust every word that the Lord says. We can wait on. We can trust in. This bridge with us. Wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. He will renew your strength. So wait, I say. Wait on the Lord. Wait on the Lord. He will renew think it's powerful when we take what the Lord has said and we sing it right back to Him. When He says that they wait on the Lord, He will renew their strength. That is powerful. So I want us to declare that together. Let's sing it. They that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount upon wings like an eagle and soar. They shall walk and not get weary. They shall run and not faint. That's what happens when you wait. It happens when you wait. Can we sing that again? That ain't wait.
They that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up upon wings like an eagle and soar. They shall walk and not get weary. They shall run. What happens when you wait? Happens when you wait. Sing it one more time. They that wait. They that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up on wings like an eagle and soar. They shall walk and not get weary. They shall run and not. That's what happens when you wait.
The wait. We can trust Him. Lexi, I'm going to ask you to pray for us.
Heavenly Father, God, we come before You as a church this morning, and Lord, I know we just repeated that a lot, waiting on You, but God, I pray that that would actually really hit our hearts this morning. Lord, I pray that it would really sink into us, Lord, that we would choose to wait on You, to wait on Your timing. God, I'm thankful that in a room this size, I know we're all waiting on something from You. And Jesus, I pray that we would be able to just humble ourselves this morning. God, I pray that Your word would speak to us and that we would be able to say, God, You're in control. You are God. We're not. God, I'm going to trust You. I've tasted your goodness. I have seen that you are good. I have seen how you are the God who moves, who hears, who listens to our prayers. God, I thank you for that. Jesus, I'm thankful for the examples that you've given us in Scripture of all the times, God, that where you've made a promise and people had to wait, sometimes hundreds of years, sometimes thousands of years, God. Lord, I just even think of you coming onto this earth, how we had to wait for that. And yet, wow, you literally had our best interest in mind. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you that you are trustworthy. Thank you that you are good. God, we love you, and I pray, Jesus, this morning that as a church family, Lord, we would surrender to this and we would say, God, we are going to wait on your timing and not ours. Thank you, Jesus. In your name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Can we give the Lord praise? Amen. Awesome. Awesome. You can be seated. Just a thought that when we wait on the Lord, we're not wasting time. And we've talked briefly the last couple of weeks about not liking to waste time. When we wait on the Lord, he's able to do what needs to be done in the time that it needs to be done. So we give him praise today. And we're going to have a time here in just a few moments where we pray for the persecuted church. This is June 6th, 2021. It's also interesting, June 6th is D-Day, right? 1944, where the Allied forces stormed the beaches there in France to take back mainland Europe from the Nazis. And just with that thought in mind of just being under fire, our brothers and sisters in many places around the world, primarily in communist countries, Muslim majority or Hindu majority countries, persecuted because they're followers of Jesus Christ. And so the church leaders there, just Christians, men, women, students, are either from a government level or from a societal level under great pressure and persecution. And the request that we often hear is not what I think, if you're like me, some of our first responses would be when we're in the middle of something very difficult, which is, Lord, get me out of this, right? Like, rescue me from this, make this pass on. They usually pray, ask God to give us perseverance to press on, but then pray for our persecutors. And that's a crazy thought, right? Like, pray for the ones who are doing the persecuting, that they would come to know that Jesus Christ is Lord and Savior. And I believe only the love of Jesus Christ can do that. And so we're going to have a prayer for them here in just a few moments. And before we do that, just an update for those of us that are regular attenders or members with our texting to give method of supporting the work of the Lord. That has been updated through the constant changing of technology. The numbers there is up on the screen. Now, if you choose to use that method, it is 833-626-7307. And know that when you give to the work of the Lord here, we're able to impact people at this point all over the world. And just another thought would be our One Child ministry here at Grace. It's a Grace Fellowship specific ministry, and that supports orphanages, and many of those orphanages are in areas of the world to where you can be persecuted for being a follower of Jesus Christ. So if you're looking for an action point, maybe beyond just praying, that may be an action point to consider today as we move forward as a church family. And so we're going to take a time to pray for our persecuted church that God would give what is needed there for his glory. Let's pray together. Father, in the name of Jesus, we lift up those who are under persecution right now, breathing the same air that we breathe, living on the same planet, but in a very, very different context. God, we ask that you would give them strength of character, perseverance to press on, to not turn from you, and that you would do powerful things in their lives. We ask that for those that are seeking harm for the people of God, that they may even think that they're doing the right thing, we ask that you would bring conviction of sin, and we pray for the persecutors this morning, Lord Jesus, that you would intervene in their hearts and in their minds and in these places, in these situations, and that you would bring even the persecutors to a genuine change of heart to where they would follow you and turn from their sin and love you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Well, Well, good morning and welcome to Grace. My name is Caleb and I'm the student pastor here at Grace. And let me tell you, we are so glad that you're here worshiping with us today. If this is your first time with us or you've been attending for a while, I want to take the time to personally invite you to Starting Point. What is Starting Point, you may ask? Well, this is your first step to getting connected here at Grace. So what does that mean? Well, this is a class designed to introduce you to our beliefs, Christianity, and to help you get connected to the small group that's perfect for you. Pastor Tony leads every Sunday at 10 a.m. right here in the lobby. So sign up or walk in to get started. Just know there's a place for you here at Grace. COVID has been a devastating time for our community struggling with substance abuse. And that's why we're so excited that Grace Recovery Church is coming back this Tuesday, June 8th at 7 p.m. in the theater. If you're interested in learning more about this incredible ministry, or you want to know how you can help, select Grace Recovery Church on your Connect card today. Now, we made a slight change to our QR code, and you'll now not only be able to fill out the Connect card, but also able to access sermon notes, safely give online, and to even register for Starting Point. Just point at the QR code in the back of the seat in front of you as if you were taking a picture and click on that little link that pops up. Remember to follow us on social media at GF West Palm Beach to add some encouragement and godly content to your daily scroll. Thanks again for worshiping with us here today. Hang on tight as Pastor Jeff continues our series, When in Rome. Have a great day, Grace.
Good morning, Grace. All right, let's take our Bibles, go to Romans chapter 1. As you're finding your place there, we want to announce that Pastor Caleb Moore, who was the one in the video, his wife Lauren, had their third baby girl on Thursday. So we praise the Lord for church growth through the Moore family, and they are there as a couple together this morning. And also, as we saw in our video, Recovery Church starts this Tuesday evening. And so we'd love to have you there just to come pray and support, or whether this is a part of your journey, or whether you just know someone and you say, man, let's go, like somebody who desperately needs this, a friend, family member, and you want to just come with them to be a loving support, we'd encourage you to come out this Tuesday evening. Now, as you know, we are in Romans chapter 1, and we have talked about this as a leadership team and in many conversations that we don't really know of a more intense section of God's Word than what we've been going through the past 3 weeks. This is basically shining a huge spotlight on the operation of the enemy of our souls. This is exposing human sin, wickedness, evil, all of the bad stuff. What we're doing is taking the light of the good news of Jesus Christ and showing this stuff for what it is. So we had mentioned this in the past, that we should expect opposition when we get to Romans chapter 1. Now, our leadership is strong. Our staff team is wonderful. But just since we've been in Romans chapter 1, verses 18 through where we'll be today, the end of chapter 1, if I could tell you all of the things that have happened, you would say, no way. We believe that we are in spiritual warfare. Even leading up to this last crazy week that culminated in yesterday afternoon, my precious wife Jen fell. She's young, she's athletic and strong, and fractured her left elbow. And so the arm has to be just like this. And so if you have a 5.5-week-old baby, that complicates life. Because even though she is an extremely independent, hardworking person, we have just agreed that for the future health of our child, she should not try to do the one-arm pickup quite yet. And so basically she had a wonderful, wonderful friend. Several of you guys who knew about this yesterday already reached out, who stayed with us last night to help her actually feed our little boy throughout the night. And a friend is there with her today. And it's just been an interesting time. walking through Romans chapter 1. So Jen's mom is going to be here this afternoon flying in to help her, and she's just an amazing. I know sometimes I'll reference like the mother-in-law stuff just like as a joke, but she truly is an amazing, amazing person, and she does not resemble the mother-in-law jokes at all. And even if she did, I would lie and just say, thanks for coming down, right? And so thank you guys for praying for our family during this time. And we know in the grand scheme of what so many walk through, there are so many situations that are so much greater in challenge, but it's just one of those things. I don't want to take up a lot of time, that since we've been in this section of God's Word, it's been very, very interesting. So this morning, let's just preach the Word. Amen? And so we're going to talk this morning about when God gives you what you think you want, from Romans 1. So our main idea here that we're going to see weaved in and out of this passage of God's Word is to be careful what you ask for. And we'll say this as well, that if at any point this morning, or it may happen throughout the entire time or at different points, to where something that the Bible speaks to, you're like, man, I don't know how I feel about that. Like, I don't know what to do with that mentally or emotionally. Know this, that the air that you breathe and that I breathe is not the air of Romans chapter 1. In the 21st century, specifically if you're from the West, the way that we view life at this point in any regard, I think, is by and large anti the Scriptures. So what I'm saying is that if there's the intensity that rises up within your belief system this morning, know that you're feeling the tension that the Word of God wants you to have. Because when this was first written in the first century, you could not have conceived of anything more radical to what the majority of people believed in that day and time. And here we are in the 21st century, and not much has changed. So this is radical stuff this morning, all right? We all on the same page? Here in this room, online, so if something, you're like, I don't know if I believe that. Know that what we're going to do this morning is walk through this line by line, word by word, and it will confront all of us at some point. Now, back in verse 21, if you want to make a note, this is sort of where all of what we're going to talk about today flows from. Verse 21 says, although they knew God, they did not honor him as God or give thanks to him, but they became futile in their thinking. So the question we're going to answer today is, why is the world so messed up? We've all had that question, right? Like, we may not ask that question. We may not, like, you know, raise that at basketball practice, but we've all seen so many reasons why the world is messed up and why is that the case. So this is going to be an intense message. If you feel like, oh my goodness, is this like what it's like all the time at this church? What is going on? Know this, that there is hope, but us feeling the intensity of God's Word is what God desires for us because He loves us. So hang on, all right? Now, last week we explored the comparison there in verse 21 of the last time that you've done something really nice for someone, whether it's making them some food, whether it's giving them a monetary gift. Outside of Christmas, birthdays, you're saying, you know what, because I believe in you, I support you, or because I'm feeling for you, I just want to give you this. Maybe you just reach down and you pull out a straight Ben Franklin out of your wallet, right? Or your backpack, and you're like, I want to give you this $100. And they say, oh, you have no idea what this means to me. I've been so down. This is such an encouragement. And they just give you a non-socially distanced hug. But then, same scenario, you give somebody $100 just to be an encouragement to them, help them out with bills, whatever it may be, and they hold that and they kind of wave it around and say, is this it? Now, all of a sudden, we start thinking other thoughts. Are you with me? It's like, all right, no longer am I like very giving in my heart. Now I feel like giving you a closed fist healing, right? Like now I'm dealing with sin and trying to talk to you like the King James Bible uses some words, right? Like I am furious because of your lack of appreciation. That's what's going on in Romans 1. Paul says that sin and brokenness in the world stems from a human refusal to honor God for who He is or give thanks to Him. And when God gives us over, remember the illustration, if you're here with us last week, to hand over the keys to our desires, our messed up sexual desires that are out of season or out of correspondence with what God designed, or our prideful desires or our desires for greed. This is what takes over when God hands us over. So what assumes custody? What does all of this stuff actually look like in a real life scenario when God gives you over to what you think you want? Well, notice verse 26 and 27. Consuming, we call it this shame-creating sexual urges. Notice verse 26. For this reason, God gave them up, handed them over to dishonorable passions. For their women exchanged natural relations for those that are contrary to nature. And the men likewise gave up natural relations with women and were consumed with passion for one another. Men committing shameless acts with men and receiving in themselves the due penalty for their error. So notice it doesn't start here. It starts with trading the glory of God for anything else. It says, verse 26 again, God gave them up to these passions. So according to Romans 1, this is very interesting that we can be passionate but be completely wrong. We can follow our hearts, but according to Scripture, our hearts are not outside of Christ going to lead us to where we need to be. The Bible teacher James Dunn says that God did not give them their desires. Rather, he gave them to what they desired and the consequence of what they desired. Romans 1 is God giving people over to what they pursue that is not God. For the archers in the room or online, it's when you try to shoot an arrow and the fletchings or the veins have been removed. Instead of the arrow flying on target, it begins to tumble. For the rocket scientist here in the room and online, it's when the stabilizing fins are removed and instead of the rocket going where it needs to go, it begins to tumble and there's an epic explosion. Now we know that reading these two verses, we have just touched on a complex and a sensitive topic for many. If you're a member of Grace Fellowship, you need to know that in 2021, we have conversations with people in our church on a regular basis who are either personally struggling with this or they have friends or family members who are. This is something that has been around ever since the fall of humanity. And we believe here at Grace Fellowship in the power of Jesus Christ, that regardless of the inclination or the temptation, Jesus Christ is an equal opportunity Savior. Hear me say that. Jesus Christ can redeem, he can transform, he can create something beautiful from our most painful chapters and our most painful scars that we've ever walked through in our lives. And if you would like to go deeper in understanding this topic, we would encourage you to check out our series from the fall of 2019, where we took 4 weeks. We basically wrote a 70-page, single-spaced, 12-font, Times New Roman for the nerds in the room manuscript on dealing with this. I don't even remember how many footnotes we had, but the title of the series is God, Sexuality, and Human Value. God, Gender, Sexuality, and Human Value. And so we go into depth on that. First message is, what does God's Word actually teach about sexuality? And then the second message is, okay, if that's true, if this is what God says, what are we supposed to do with that in our day and time with people that we love? So if you want to know some more about that, I would encourage you to go there and listen to that series. But Romans 1 is, because people did not honor God for who he is, God said, you want to pursue something else, then when he hands them over, people are allowed to reap the fruits of their desires. It is purposefully living in the dark, because outside of God, there is no light. It means that whether it's 2,000 years ago or today, if God is removed as the standard, the personal standard for right and wrong, you ultimately end with this thin veneer of something called consent. If you've actually thought about sexual ethics, and that's the only thing that defines right from wrong, you realize that you are walking on something that cannot support our most deeply cherished moral beliefs on children and on adults. And let me say this, in context with Romans chapter 1, not long ago in certain churches, there are pastors who would not even read this because of the obvious uncomfortability it brings to a church. Whether this is our temptation or whether we cannot imagine people being tempted by this. But it's in the Word of God, so we're going to read it and we're going to try to explain it because God gave it to us because He loves us. Guys, in the 21st American church, we've got it. I don't know if COVID has helped. I think in many regards it has in this way. To get over church being something that just gets you through a case of the Mondays. God help us. If that's all that it is, drink a Dr. Pepper if you're not diabetic. Like, we can all do, I mean, get up. Like, use multiple alarm clocks. Like, the Word of God is not just to give you some pep in your step. It's to help you understand why the world is messed up and to guide us to say, okay, there's an answer, and the answer has a name, and His name is Jesus Christ. Like, we've got to get over this stuff. I need to go to church. It won't make me feel good. For how long? That wasn't in the notes. Pray for me. We're never going to get through this. I'm not even kidding. In Romans 1, in the context, this for those of us, this may be helpful. Sexual sin, heterosexual unfaithfulness, homosexual acts, that is not, in Romans 1, the source of decay. The source of societal and personal decay comes from refusing to honor God or thank Him for being who He is. That means it does not matter if you were the 40-year-old virgin and you got married at 42. Notice how quiet it is in the room. I don't care. Or if you have lived a life of exploring every type of sexual experience, a life that says, this is my life, it's my degree, it's my job, it's my boat, it's my car, it's my team, it's my life. Through sexual sin or through self-promotion and trying to chase after number one, both of those lead to a place of spiritual darkness. Don't get hung up here. This, exchanging the natural man for the woman, woman for the man, that is simply an outflow of a life that says, I'm going to ignore God. Trading God's glory and knowing Him and living for Him, that is the wellspring of every jacked up thing that humanity has ever thought. I'm trying. So what assumes custody when God gives you over to what you think you want? Notice verse 28 continues. And since they did not see fit to acknowledge God, God gave them up to a debased mind to do what ought not to be done. Now, notice it's because they did not see fit. In other words, in my plan for my life, God doesn't factor in. What factors in are my plans. Therefore, in my goal of how I want to live my life, it doesn't fit. Doesn't make sense for me to acknowledge God and obey and follow Him. You see, it's not that we have a problem with gods or the idea of God. The human heart is an idol factory. That's what Calvin said. It's not the fact of, well, we don't believe that there's an evidence for anything outside the natural realm. It's just that, all, myself included, all of us, when confronted by God, it's just that we don't want Him to be God. Because if He's God, He gets to say something about my sex life. If He's God, He gets to say something about, no, Jeff, that's actually not your money, that's my money. If He's God, then He actually gets to say something about forgiveness and revenge. If He's God and I'm not God, He's the one who gets to say, you've got to let go of your hate and allow my love to fill you. It's not that we don't want God, it's just that we don't want the God of the Bible. Naturally, outside of Christ, and by the way, that's the reason why Jeff Robinson and every single one of us needs a Savior. But society says this, we all, no, here's the thing, no matter if you are like super left or right wing politically or whether you're like straight down the middle, everybody says, follow your heart. Listen to your heart. Scripture says if you do that, you end up in a bad place. Do what makes you happy. Okay, let's think. Tons of smart people here in South Florida in this room. Let's think, if you're Christian or not, how do you know that your wanter is actually functioning properly? How do you know that? Well, it makes me happy. How do you not know that what's driving you, what has set the parameters for what makes you happy, is not malfunctioning? How do you know the GPS of your soul is not sending you off a cliff? Scripture talks about the noetic effects of sin. We'll be there in about 3 weeks, about how when humanity fell away from God, that even the faculty of our mind does not function the way it should. It turns inward. And by the way, for our thinkers in the room, ethics does not exist in a logical vacuum. Whatever you think is logical is formed by your ethics. More about that in several weeks. Between now and then, you just put it in your pipe and smoke it. You say, but Jeff, I want that. That makes me happy. How do you know that that's what should make you happy? And how do you know that happiness in itself is not just the ether of a pipe dream of the soul? Welcome to Grace. I know this is super encouraging. Hang on, we're going to get to hope. Jonathan Edwards, great pastor here several hundred years ago, gave the illustration about this concept, that if you take a line that's just a degree or two off of where it needs to be in terms of hitting the target, the longer the line goes, the further off you are. It's one thing for a Play-Doh project with the kids on the dining room table to not be exactly plumb, but it's another thing that the longer a person lives, the more a society goes on, the more a family grows together, if it's not focused on the honor and the glory of God, you will grow further and further apart, and you're aiming for Mars, but you end up in a different galaxy altogether. That's why refusing to acknowledge God is the pathway to intellectual corruption. There are some who say, well, Pastor Jeff, I've been reading my Bible, and there are several examples where it seems like God is engaged in trying to, you know, confuse people. Let me give you four of those. And by the way, we've got notes for days. Hop on our website. We've got detailed notes for explaining some of these concepts. Pray for me. I'm going to run through four right now. What about cases in the Bible where God seems to deceive or not deliver people? Because it seems like in Romans 1, God's just handing people over to their desires. God hardening Pharaoh's heart. Story, Pharaoh, a brutal king and dictator, had enslaved God's people, an entire ethnic group, and on top of that, he had decreed infanticide for all the baby boys. Not exactly the guy you want to lead the Bible study in your small group. It says that God hardened Pharaoh's heart. That's what the word says. Back and forth, it even says that Pharaoh at certain times hardened his heart. People say, how is it just for God to harden Pharaoh's heart? Pharaoh's heart was already hard. You don't show up. I can't wait to lead the prayer at praise team practice. Oh, by the way, and after this, I'm going to go commit infanticide. God gave Pharaoh more of what Pharaoh had already pursued. You get that? 2 Chronicles 18, where there's one of the most corrupt kings, and I know, we're in very encouraging territory here in the Word of God this morning, that the Old Testament ever had. His name was Ahab. He had pursued lies and falsehood and idolatry, and God allowed these lying spirits to go into the mouths of these false prophets who prophesied falsely to Ahab. He believed it, and it brought him to his just doom. People read that and say, "How it seems like God's trying to deceive people." No, Ahab had pursued, listen, a life of self-deception. Every time God sent a prophet to Ahab, he tried to kill the prophet. He tried to burn the right. He tried to push God out of his life. So finally, God says, you want self-deception? Have a barrel full. Number three, Thessalonians chapter 2, verses 8 through 12. This is in the end times, to where the scripture says that God will send a strong delusion, verse 10, because they refuse to love the truth. So according to scripture, faith is not necessarily intellectual, it is moral. Who do you love? That's the greatest question. Therefore, verse 11, God sends them a strong delusion so that they may believe what is false, in order that all may be condemned who did not believe the truth and had pleasure in unrighteousness. This is a picturesque of the end times, to where men and women will pursue everything but God, and God finally gives them what they have pursued. According to Romans 1, hands them over. Here's the keys. And finally, verse 4, Jesus is imperative to listen to the truth. Matthew 11:15, Jesus says, he who has ears, let him here. Why did Jesus say that, brothers and sisters? Because when we hear truth and we respond to truth, it transforms our hearts. But if we hear truth and we know it's truth and we push it away, then it begins to harden our hearts. When God hands people over, it is always the last crescendo of a life that has been lived in pursuit of God, in pursuit of everything other than God. So what assumes custody when God gives you over to what you think you want? Well, verses 29 through 32 basically lay out a pattern of, we call it cruel behavior. This is what it looks like. This is what bubbles to the surface. This is what controls men and women when God does not. They were filled, verse 29, filled with all manner of unrighteousness, evil. Okay, what does that look like? We're just going to go through this. Covetousness, that's drooling over stuff. Being obsessed with possessions. Malice, that's cutthroat in the academic and the business world. They are full of envy. Envy is, I deserve what you have, and if you have what I don't have, I'm going to try to tear you down. Envy hates it when other people succeed. Murder. If you've ever done research into the number of unsolved murders in our country, it is disturbing. Had conversations with people who have either committed or been families of the victims of rural and urban murders. Even when I was moving here 5 years ago, there was a student that was in my student ministry years ago and just didn't respond to Jesus, even though I worked with them and I love this guy. He was a young man at the time, and I got a call as we were driving down from Virginia to move here to be with you guys, and said FB got shot up at a drug deal gone bad. So I go into the hospital room, and he's there on everything imaginable, four bullet holes in him, and I lean over, and he's on oxygen, and I say, hey, bro, you think this is the wake-up call? I say, man, I remember our times in student ministry where we study God's word, and afterwards we do jiu-jitsu and grappling, and I don't know, some of you, that was then and there. I said, is this your wake-up call? And what do you think God's trying to say to you? Pulls it off. He said, hey, bro, I just survived four gunshots. And then he adopted this, like, Superman mentality that nothing can take me down. I still pray for him. I love him. Love that dude to death. But sin, if we don't respond to Christ, will change our minds into crazy town. Strife. It's where we don't feel at home unless there's drama. Deceit. It's tax fraud. Ponzi schemes. Charging people more than what's fair. Pay-to-play schemes. Claiming it's for the children when it's actually not. Maliciousness, which is looking for a way to cut other people down so we look better than they do. It's kind of the crabs pulling the other crabs back into the bucket when they try to get out. They are gossips. That means confident about breaking, or passionate about breaking confidentiality. And right here I would say to, we could say this, maybe our church crowd, that back when we read verse 26 and 27, often the response can be, I have no idea how anybody could ever be tempted by those types of things. If you're a gossip, if you can't keep confidence, Romans 1 is about you too. Are we tracking? Yep. Romans 1 is not a place where I can look and say, psh, I have no idea how anybody could ever do that. My goodness, what's kids these days? What's this country coming to? Romans 1 doesn't let me do that. Because what's in the mix, next to murder, strife, deceit, maliciousness, and they are gossips. If you claim to be a follower of Christ, but you can't not gossip, you really need to reevaluate and see if you actually know Christ. Y'all all right? Slanderers, verse 30. It's cancel culture. Because I don't like what you say, I'm going to try to destroy you. I will take something that you said that you didn't actually mean, and I'm going to take that and morph that into something else. Haters of God. What's more hateful, to be a virulent atheist or to totally ignore God? Think about it like this. What hurts more, when somebody cusses you out or when somebody will not even look at you? haters of God. Insolent, no one can tell me anything, refusing to hear or listen. By the way, this is what eventually describes a life, comes to the surface when God is not in control. Haughty, acting as if there is no God. That's saying because I have more money, more education, more brilliance, physically stronger, my skin color is different, and therefore I'm better than this person or this group. Boastful, it's blatant and chronic self-promotion. Inventors of evil. By the way, this is the reason why we have no pictures today in this sermon. Illustrate this for me. No. Inventors of evil. If you need that explained, talk to one of our other leaders. Disobedient to parents. Foolish. That means being absolutely confident and boisterous, pounding the table, all caps on Twitter, but actually not knowing anything. Faithless means no loyalty. Heartless, no mercy. Ruthless, dead set on looking out for number one. Now, here's what's interesting. What we just read, by the way, we can come up for air now, all right? We can breathe. If you practice this stuff in a strategic way, Robert Greene's The 48 Laws of Power, you can accumulate respect, you can accumulate money, you can gain for yourself power. I mean, think about all of what was just leveraged here. You talk about view count. You talk about people fearing you. Man, you can build your very own kingdom if you practice this stuff in a smart way. But at what cost? Verse 32, though they knew God's righteous decree and those who practice such things deserve to die, they not only do them but give approval to those who practice them. The scripture says that the soul that sins, it shall die. The fact of our sin is our death. The reason why we are still alive, it's because of God's mercy. It's because all sin is ultimately directed towards God. So what we're saying here is that a corrupted mind, a mind that pursues anything other than the glory of God, a corrupted mind and heart are not static. They don't just sit there. But that thoughts eventually give way to behavior. Are we tracking with that? Everything that we just saw, all of the messed up, disgusting behaviors stem from and flow from a refusal to acknowledge God as God. Now notice the progressive digression, that lust can never be satisfied. Lust ends with self-hatred and the hatred of others. Lust promises to fulfill our desires, but it ends up dehumanizing us and those that we sin with. Now here's the thing. Don't raise your hand. You don't have to acknowledge. You don't have to move a muscle. But every single one of us have been to this place. Man, I can't believe I did that. I can't, what was I thinking? Or I can't believe I did that again. Like, I know better. I was raised better. What's wrong with me? And sin ultimately outside of Christ will lead us to self-hatred or a life of blaming everything else and everyone else. And then outside of Christ, sin calls and we have no choice but to ultimately answer. And you say, well, Pastor Jeff, I'm into trying to modify my behavior and so forth. Well, ultimately, the scriptures deal with our heart, and what we do on the outside flows from our hearts. So if you get the heart right, you can get the behavior right. What we just read, nobody wants this in their home. Like, how many of us got married and like, I can't wait to have verse 28 and 29 be my life, full of envy? Can't wait to come home. Hey, guess what happened at work? Oh, didn't happen to me. Boastful. Like full of envy. Like nobody wants this, but here's the thing. Outside of Christ, even if everything looks good, even if we're faithful to our spouse, even if we don't cheat on taxes, I don't know what that means. That was like the most visible response. We're in South Florida, Grace Online, all right? But anything other than living a life to honor and glorify Christ leads us to a place of death. It is purposely choosing to live in the dark. So, see, Pastor Jeff, I thought you said there's going to be some hope, and I've been listening to this sermon for like now the past hour and a half. At least that's how long that it seems. You know, I haven't heard any yet. All right, let's ask the question, where do we go from here? If you're a follower of Christ, is there a lie that you have exchanged the truth of the gospel for? Is there something that's being entertained in your mind? Anything from materialism, from being focused on stuff, to racial hatred, to using people as things? Where is it? And here's the reality. We all struggle with something. Amen? You say, Pastor Jeff, what does it mean that I'm tempted all the time? It means that you're alive. Good job. But even our temptations that are not sin in of themselves, whether that's to commit homosexual sin, to be unfaithful with your spouse, heterosexual, whatever it is, the temptations themselves are not sin, but they are a reflection to the deeper brokenness that we all have inside. Our temptations are a clarion call that we all need a Savior. Man, guys, what I'm trying to say this morning is that sin is really, really messed up. It's painful. It's not fun to be sinned against. It's not fun when we sin because all the guilt and the shame. But I'm so thankful for Jesus Christ because He's the one who can come to us and say, your sin does not scare me. He is the one who is greater than our sin. Amen. So what we're trying to say this morning is that Romans 1 details the most horrific aspects of human nature, but that brings us to the place of humility, saying, I need what I can't do. I need Jesus. And guess what? That's the best place to be. And if it takes 30, 35, 40, 55, 2-hour sermon to get there, it's absolutely worth it. So where do we go from here? Romans 12, 1 and 2. I appeal to you, therefore, brothers, by the mercies of God, to present your bodies. Here's what we do, guys. Here's what we do. Your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. Do not be conformed to this world. Come on. But be transformed by the renewing of your mind. Romans 1 is about how outside God, the mind becomes empty and futile and confused. But through the power of Jesus Christ, don't miss this, our minds can be transformed. Amen. That by testing, you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. If there has never been a point in your life to where Jesus has gained control of your heart, if there's never been a time to where your life on the outside has been changed by something Christ has done on the inside, today is the day of salvation. I'm not asking you if you have been christened or confirmed or baptized at the beach, or whether you're a religious person, or whether you don't cheat on your taxes, or any of those questions. But has there been a point to where Christ has changed your heart? Has there been a point to where the keys of your life have been handed to Jesus? Guys, we have people attend here every week, online, every week without fail. Has Christ changed your heart? Romans 1 leads to Romans 2, where God's kindness is what leads us to repentance. Wouldn't it be an awesome thing that through all of this heavy lifting and like, my goodness, I've never been to a church where it seems like that, like there's just so much intensity and pressure. Listen, what we're trying to do is to read what God has given us because He loves us, and He's not just about a quick fix. He's about our long-term spiritual health and our joy. You say, man, I don't know what to do with this stuff. Here's what you do. You come to Jesus and you say, Jesus, here I am. All my sin, all my shame, change me. Jesus, save me. And He will do it. The great Messiah, the Christ the one who has prophesied, the one who is, was, and is to come, Jesus Christ, the Son of God, can hear in the 21st century in West Palm Beach, Florida, change your life. You say, Pastor Jeff, man, I'm watching from Grace Online. I hear there's a lot of crazy stuff that goes down in SoFlo, bro. I'm not sure if I want to move down. Jesus Christ is active in South Florida. He's active in this county. He's active in this world. And I look across this room, and I wish we had time to just have an open mic for some of you to get up and say, my life was this, but then Jesus changed me. Praise be to his name. There's testimonies all across this room of minds that were darkened by sin, but who Christ transformed. Praise be to his name. You are here as a testimony to the power of Jesus Christ. So when the world gets crazy, the church of Jesus Christ, we just get serious about who Jesus is. We say, yes, the world's crazy. Yes, it's messed up. But you know what? Christ is in control, and he is stronger. He is greater. And I'm not going to back down. I'm going to press on for his glory. So we don't share Romans 1 to say, oh, it's doom and gloom. Oh, the world's going to hell in a handbasket. What's going to happen to the country? We say Jesus Christ is on the throne, and we will serve him and we will love him until the day that we die. Amen? So if you believe that the Lord is, I'm still trying, brother. If you believe that the Lord is speaking to your heart today, we would ask that you would take a step, fill out that connect card there on that seat or a digital connect card, and just say, I'm committing my life to Jesus Christ, and we'll contact you, one of our team members, and walk with you in your new walk with Christ. And we cannot stress that enough, the need to reach out so we can do a life and community together. Now, we're going to observe a time of responding to God's word through communion. So you want to take your communion cup at this point and take off, this is very important as well, the cover for the bread, because if you take the cover of the juice off first, as we say often, you will baptize yourself in grape juice. So I'm going to take that, and Pastor Lowe is going to sing a song over us, and as he's singing, just do business with the Lord, and ask the Lord to do a work in your heart and in your mind. Pastor Lowe.
I can't go back to the beginning. Can't control what tomorrow will bring, but I know here in the middle is the place where you promised to be. I'm not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Would you meet me here again? I'm not enough unless you come. Will you meet me here again? 'Cause all I want is all you are. Will you meet me here again?
Here at Grace, we believe that communion is for believers in Jesus, those who have repented and turned from their sin, place their faith in Christ. So if that's not yet happened in your life, we would encourage you to observe during this time until the point to where you give your life to Christ. Just prior to his crucifixion, Jesus met with his disciples to share the Passover meal. During the meal, he took the bread and gave thanks for it, broke it, and told them, "This is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then Jesus took the cup and told them that he would not drink from it again until his kingdom comes. Then he said, "This cup that is poured out for you is the new covenant in my blood. Do this in remembrance of me." We We are thankful that the scripture tells us that the blood of Jesus cleanses from all sin. Brothers and sisters, if some of Romans 1 described your life before Christ, know this, that you no longer live in the zip code of shame. You live in the zip code of the love of Jesus Christ. Again, praise be to his precious name. Let's stand together as we pray. Father, in Jesus' name, we pray that you'll take your word and imprint it on our hearts. Help us to know that there is hope in you and hope in nowhere else and no one else ultimately for what we need most. Lord, bring us back next week as we talk about how your kindness is what leads us to repentance. Give us grace, give us peace, we pray, in the midst of the storm. In Jesus' name, amen. May the Lord bless you. We love you.